There is within all of us a door which opens onto divine knowledge, within ourselves, yet beyond ourselves. The Western temperament would have to find its own doors to these perceptions. And so, many teachers came west, bringing the wisdom of the East. Georges Gurdjieff was such a spiritual teacher, a mystic, a hypnotist, and quite a beautiful composer of Armenian and Greek descent. He taught that most humans lived their lives in a state of hypnotic waking sleep, but could awaken to higher states of consciousness. Gurdjieff's method was the work, or the system. It would unite the methods of the fakir, the monk, and the yogi, and thus he referred to it as the fourth way. The fakir concentrates on the body alone, the monk on feeling, and the yogi on the mind. The fourth way would integrate all three into a new synthesis, affecting simultaneously every side of man's being. It would require no commitment to a guru, saint, or idol, or adherence to ritual practice in temple, ashram, or a commune, nor to eat certain foods and abstain from others. The repertoire of the work included a variety of exercises for concentration and self-awareness, of movements and dances, derived from his time spent in Sufi monasteries in Central Asia, the travels he chronicled in meetings with remarkable men. The work was work on oneself, a kind of self-confrontation, a coming to self-knowing. We walked along past colorful shops, hearing the sounds of cowbells, prayers from the temples. I took up the smell of cardamom, coriander, and peanut oil, and soon we were at the open-air market, behind which was a palace. There were sellers upon sellers, all with beautifully displayed spices, pyramids of chili, ginger, cumin, black and green cardamom, cinnamon, turmeric, saffron. From the palace comes the scent of roses, amber, and jasmine. We walk inside. With its immense and ornate decorative ceilings, the palace conjures up a vision of splendor and magnificence. There is an exhibition inside, the Master Jewelers. Along the paneled walls are extraordinary pictures of regal, wealthy kings, princesses, and high society, displaying the most detailed and elaborate jewels and necklaces I had ever seen. In one case was a particularly beautiful diamond necklace with rubies that caught Shakti's attention. India's great wealth was not only filled with metaphysical insights, but equally architectural, musical, culinary, sexual, and scientific, and an immense sense of refinement and beauty, as could be seen in the many pictures of beautiful and handsome Maharishis. One caption reads, "The flamboyant Maharishi arrived at Bucharan in 1927, accompanied by a retinue of 40 servants, all wearing pink turbans, his 20 favorite dancing girls, and most important of all, 6 caskets filled with 7,571 diamonds, 1,432 emeralds, sapphires, rubies, and pearls of incomparable beauty." Ah, oh, I think, the sadhu and the maharishi. Ah, the beauty and delectations of this material world. By this point, we are ravenous. Outside the palace, we jump onto a cycle rickshaw and soon zoom along, darting potholes, cows, and passerbys. I enjoy the shift of speed from walking on foot to rolling along in this human-propelled car. The driver looks back and smiles as he drops us off outside what looks like an old theater. He points to the rooftop. Very nice, he says. Along the stairs are many theater posters, one for the Hindu epic Mahabharata, directed by Peter Brook. The original play was 9 hours long and toured around the world for 4 years. Apparently, it was staged here. We are already engulfed by the smells of turmeric and curry and the sounds of the sitar as we continue up looking at the posters. I read an interview with the British director, a devotee of Gurdjieff, principally a theater director who had made a film adaptation of Meetings with Remarkable Men, asking him the question of what to give to the inner search and what to the outer search. Yes, he said, it was an age-old dilemma. What belongs to the realm of this world and what belongs to this something else, which are both the same worlds, he said. Brooke recalled a period in his life where he says, deep down, nothing could quench a sense of meaninglessness, both in my own activities and in the world around me. Yet to solve this by breaking away or dropping out seemed arrogant to him. What should I legitimately give to each, he would ask himself. Brooke, who wrote of the theater in a lovely book, The Empty Space, Theater as Deadly, Holy, Rough, and Immediate, created a theater where the actor and the audience together would be vehicles for the search within to reach together a higher state. The theater would place them into a new consciousness, hopefully leaving the audience with some type of revelation within themselves. I like that. Yes, his desire was like Antonin Artaud's, to abolish the separation between the audience's space and the performance space.
Cela faisait ce qu'on appelle